Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. You're very welcome to our Church of Our Lady Assumed into Heaven here in Dunbeg on this Palm Sunday. It's a very unusual time in our world, and today for the Hock family, it is a very unusual time for them as well, as we gather to bury, or to pray for today and to bury tomorrow, our beloved pastor, Father Joe. Father Joe, our thoughts and our prayers are with you as you speed your way to heaven. And our thoughts and prayers are also with his beloved family as we reach out at this time, especially to John in Castlebar, to Father Gerard in Bolton in the UK, Tom Greenmean, to his sisters Carmel Maloney in Kildysert, Sister Anne in Nottingham, and his sisters-in-law, his nieces, nephews, grandnieces, grandnephews, relatives, friends, and parishioners. We have just brought Father Joe's coffin through the parish of Dunbeg to be embraced by the love of the parishioners he served here for almost 25 years. And on this Palm Sunday, we remember that we gather, and our faith tells us that Jesus is always with us in our time of suffering, as we spend this special week remembering his suffering on the cross and the glory of his resurrection. And so we begin our ceremony here today by blessing the palms. Almighty ever-living God, sanctify these branches with your blessing, that we who follow Christ the King in exaltation may reach the eternal Jerusalem through him who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. And as Father Joe constantly welcomed Jesus into his life, so we place palm on his coffin on this day and pray that he will rejoice in the glory of the saints and angels in heaven. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. And to prepare ourselves as we gather, conscious of our own frailty, acknowledging that we trust in God's mercy for us. Lord Jesus, you have shown us the way to the Father. Lord, have mercy. Lord Jesus, you have given us the consolation of the truth. Christ, have mercy. Lord Jesus, you are the good shepherd leading us into everlasting life. Lord, have mercy. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Amen. We pray. Almighty ever-living God, who as an example of humility for the human race to follow, caused our Saviour to take flesh and submit to the cross, graciously grant that we may heed his lesson of patient suffering, and so merit a share in his resurrection, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, for ever and ever. Amen. A reading from the prophet Isaiah. The Lord has given me a disciple's tongue, so that I may know how to reply to the wearied. He provides me with speech. Each morning he wakes me to hear, to listen like a disciple. The Lord has opened my ear. For my part I made no resistance, neither did I turn away. I offered my back to those who struck me, my cheeks to those who tore at my beard. I did not cover my face against insult and spittle. The Lord comes to my help, so that I am untouched by the insults, and so too I set my face like flint. I know I shall not be shamed. The word of the Lord. My God, why have you forsaken me? My God, why have you forsaken me? All who see me deride me. They curled their lips, they tossed their heads. He trusted in the Lord, let him save him. Let him release him if this is his friend. My God, why have you forsaken me? Many dogs have surrounded me. A band of the wicked beset me. They tear holes in my hands and my feet. I can count every one of my bones. My God, why have you forsaken me? They divide my clothing among them. They cast lots for my robe. O Lord, do not leave me alone. My strength make haste to help me. My God, why have you forsaken me? I will tell of your name to my brethren and praise you where they have assembled. You who fear the Lord, give him praise. All sons of Jacob, give him glory. Revere him, Israel's sons. My God, why have you forsaken me? A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Philippians. His state was divine, yet Jesus Christ did not cling to his equality with God, but emptied himself to assume the condition of a slave and become as men are. And being as all men are, he was humbler yet, even to accepting death, death on a cross. But God raised him high and gave him the name which is above all other names, so that all beings in the heavens, on earth, and in the underworld should bend the knee at the name of Jesus, and that every tongue should acclaim Jesus Christ as Lord to the glory of God the Father. The word of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ, King of eternal glory. Christ was humbler yet, even to accepting death, death on a cross. But God raised him high and gave him the name which is above all names. Praise to you, O Christ, King of eternal glory. The Lord be with you. The Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew. Jesus was brought before Pontius Pilate, the governor, and the governor put to him this question, "Are you the king of the Jews?" Jesus replied, "It is you who say it." But when he was accused by the chief priests and the elders, he refused to answer at all. Pilate then said to him, "Do you not hear how many charges they have brought against you?" But to the governor's complete amazement, he offered no reply to any of the charges. At festival time, it was the governor's practice to release a prisoner for the people, anyone they chose. Now there was at that time a notorious prisoner whose name was Barabbas. So when the crowd gathered, Pilate said to them, "Which do you want me to release for you, Barabbas or Jesus, who is called Christ?" For Pilate knew it was out of jealousy that they had handed him over. Now as he was seated at the chair of judgment, his wife sent him a message. "Have nothing to do with that man. I have been upset all day by a dream I had about him." The chief priests and the elders, however, had persuaded the crowd to demand the release of Barabbas and the execution of Jesus. So when the governor spoke and asked them, "Which of the two do you want me to release for you?" they said, "Barabbas." But in that case, Pilate said to them, "What am I to do with Jesus, who is called Christ?" They all said, "Let him be crucified." "Why?" he asked. "What harm has he done?" But they shouted all the louder, "Let him be crucified." Then Pilate saw that he was making no impression, that in fact a riot was imminent. So he took some water, washed his hands in front of the crowd and said, "I am innocent of this man's blood. It is your concern." And the people to a man shouted back, "His blood be upon us and on our children." Then he released Barabbas for them. He ordered Jesus to be first scourged and handed over to be crucified. The governor's soldiers took Jesus with them into the praetorium and collected the whole cohort round him. Then they stripped him and made him wear a scarlet cloak, and having twisted some thorns into a crown, they put this on his head and placed a reed in his right hand. To make fun of him, they knelt to him, saying, "Hail, King of the Jews." And they spat on him and took the reed and struck him on the head with it. And when they had finished making fun of him, They took off the cloak and dressed him in his own clothes and led him away to crucify him. On their way out, they came across a man from Cyrene, Simon by name, and enlisted him to carry his cross. When they had reached the place called Golgotha, that is the place of the skull, they gave him wine to drink mixed with gall, which he tasted but refused to drink. When they had finished crucifying him, they shared out his clothing by casting lots, and then sat down and stayed there, keeping guard over him. Above his head was placed a charge against him. It read, "This is Jesus, the King of the Jews." At the same time, two robbers were crucified with him, one on the right and one on the left. The passers-by jeered at him. They shook their heads and said, "So you would destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days. Then save yourself. If you are God's son, come down from the cross." The chief priests with the scribes and elders mocked him in the same way. "He saved others," they said. "He cannot save himself. He is the King of Israel. Let him come down from the cross now, and we will believe in him." He put his trust in God. Now let God rescue him if he wants him. For he did say, "I am the Son of God." Even the robbers who were crucified with him taunted him in the same way. From the sixth hour, there was darkness over the whole land until the ninth hour. Then at about the ninth hour, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani," that is, my God, why have you deserted me?" When some of those who stood there heard this, they said, "The man is calling on Elijah." And one of them quickly ran to get a sponge, which he dipped in vinegar, and putting it on a reed, gave it to him to drink. "Wait," said the rest of them, "and see if Elijah will come to save him." But Jesus, again crying out in a loud voice, yielded up his spirit. At that, the veil of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth quaked, the rocks were split, the tombs opened, and the bodies of many holy men rose from the dead. And these, after his resurrection, came out of the tombs, entered the holy city, and appeared to a number of people. Meanwhile, the centurion, together with others guarding Jesus, had seen the earthquake and all that was taking place. And they were terrified and said, "In truth, this was a son of God." The Gospel of the Lord. When I looked at that story of the Passion over the week, and conscious of Father Joe, there was one little phrase that stood out for me in it, where the crowd say, as Jesus hangs on the cross, "He put his trust in God." And Joe was a man who all his life put his trust in God. My association with Father Joe goes back to my childhood, when he was ministering in the Diocese of Brentwood in England. Joe, on his holidays back home, would always call in to see my dad and my mum. And I was a young little nipper sitting around the kitchen table at that stage. But Joe always came for the cup of tea and always came for the visit. And that was the beginning of my association with him. And in many ways, some way, the hand of God is in that journey, because now I am very happy and privileged to be with him as we bid him farewell from our earthly existence. Joe ministered in Brentwood for a number of years, then came back to the diocese and served in the parish of Kilmaley, and then in Corrifin, and then moved back to West Clare in Cross, and 25 years ago came here to the parish of Dunbeg. And they have been 25 years of very faithful and fruitful service to the Lord in his ministry here. 63 years of priestly service in total. In his time here, Joe's attention to detail in the parish was constant. We have the erection of our beautiful new school here in Dunbeg as testimony to his stewardship, an example of his great stewardship. His care for Belaha and Dunbeg churches, his works on the boards of management of the schools of our parish, his constant pastoral visitation, and we got a sample of the journeys that he made this afternoon as we travelled through the parish. His interest in community life in Dunbeg and its various organisations, and principally, of course, in the football all his life. And we will always remember the phrase, the long ball. His particular attention and care of the sick. And on a day like today, I'm especially reminded of the celebration of his funeral masses here over the years. Just about a year ago, I'm glad I did it one day in the sacristy after a funeral. I said to Joe, "Joe, you really celebrate a lovely, prayerful funeral mass." And he always did. And the phrases that he had at the time of funeral were very pithy, always repeated, but they are gems. They are going from us, and we cannot bid them stay. The people we know and love leave us in their ones, their twos, and their threes. Some live to a ripe old age. Some are taken younger. But, he would say, we are a Christian people, and we have the good news. And the good news is very simple, he'd say. Life after death. We have another life to look forward to. He put his trust in God. Over the past months, some of us have had the privilege of being with him on his journey through failing health. But I'm always have been conscious of that all who knew him and all who worked with him and all in the parish were with us on that journey. Joe was a fighter. And Bernie and myself, we know it. Because when we would try to make suggestions about his care, he was well able to fight his corner. When he'd see the two of us coming, I think he used to brace himself up. But he had great support from you, his family, all through this and all through his life. From Paddy and Patricia, his Flanagan and his neighbours in Belaha, from his doctors, from Áine Mull Hall, and from Dr. Mary O'Sullivan, from his carers, his nurse Mary Nolan, from his friends that he used to phone, and in particular Mert, with whom he used to keep in contact with. He had always people and friends he could reach out to. He had support always from our present pastoral council members and from all the former members down through the years, from all the people he met with here, our sacristans, Liz and all of you who helped out here, from our readers, choirs, Eucharistic ministers, the servers, all through the years, always have a special place in their heart for Joe and Joe for them. From the entire parish, as we've seen today. And each of us hold a memory of him. In particular, his dedication, his determination, and his commitment to carry out his priestly duties right up to the end. He put his trust in God. So, Lord, as we begin this Holy Week, remembering your journey to the cross and resurrection, we ask you to gather Father Joe into your eternal home. May his strong faith win him the crown of victory. He put his trust in God. Father Joe, we will pray for you. May God and Mary be with you, and may you pray for us. And so we bring our prayer to God on this Palm Sunday. He who is our strength and who makes haste to help us. We pray for the Church of God throughout the world at this time, that Christians everywhere may mark Holy Week in their homes with faith and devotion. Lord, hear us. For our community, that even as we stay apart at this time, we may mind each other and pray for each other. Lord, hear us. For those who work on the front line of healthcare, that they may be preserved safe from every danger. Lord, hear us. For all who are sick or anxious because of COVID-19, that God may comfort and heal them. Lord, hear us. We pray for those who have gone before us in life's journey. We pray especially this Sunday for Father Joe. May all our deceased journey through the valley of death to resurrection. Lord, hear us. God of compassion, in the death and resurrection of Jesus, you show your love for us. Hear our petitions and grant them through Christ our Lord. Amen. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have this bread to offer, which earth has given and human hands have made. It will become for us the bread of life. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have this wine to offer, fruit of the vine and work of human hands. It will become our spiritual drink. And pray now that our sacrifice may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Through the passion of your only begotten Son, O Lord, may our reconciliation with you be near at hand, so that though we do not merit it by our own deeds, yet by this sacrifice made once for all, we may feel already the effects of your mercy. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For though innocent, he suffered willingly for sinners and accepted unjust condemnation to save the guilty. His death has washed away our sins, and his resurrection has purchased our justification. And so with all the angels we praise you, as in joyful celebration we acclaim. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the font of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread, and giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Save us, Savior of the world, for by your cross and resurrection you have set us free. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, Fintan, our Bishop, and all ministers of your gospel. Remember your servant, Father Joe, whom you have called from this world to yourself. Grant that as he was united with your Son in a death like his, he may also be one with him in his resurrection. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with the blessed apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever. Amen. So we pray the great prayer that Jesus has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, grant us peace. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof. Only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Nourished with these sacred gifts, we humbly beseech you, O Lord, that just as through the death of your Son you have brought us to hope for what we believe, so by his resurrection you may lead us to where you call. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. We ask for your continued prayers during this Holy Week. And tomorrow, here in our church in Dunbeg, Bishop Finton will be with us for the funeral mass for Father Joe. At this time, we pray, and especially for all those in our healthcare and our emergency services, and those at the front line in this battle against the coronavirus. Those of us who were able to visit with Father Joe in his last few days know the tremendous work that our nursing staff do in our nursing homes, and especially we're very grateful for the excellent care that Father Joe received in Regina House. And so we pray for all who are tending to the need of the sick at this time. And the Lord be with you all. Look, we pray, O Lord, on this your family, for whom our Lord Jesus Christ did not hesitate to be delivered into the hands of the wicked and submit to the agony of the cross, who lives and reigns for ever and ever. Amen. May Almighty God bless you all, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our Mass is ended now. We go to love and serve the Lord.